Service, we'll be singing Psalm number 10, "He hideth my soul." And if you stand, let me get there.
Preaching through the book of Acts. chapter 15. So we'll go ahead and we will pick up there where we left off. Begin reading in verse 19. If you stand for the reading of God's word. So they have come and they have brought a question to the church of Jerusalem. And it is about, again, the Judaizers have come forth. They have made some accusations saying that you're not really saved unless you're circumcised. And so they send a delegation, if you will, to Jerusalem, to the church of Jerusalem, that they might listen, that they might hear, again, what is being put forth, and then come with an answer. And so that's where we're at here. Wherefore, my sentence is that we trouble not them, again, the Gentiles who have just gotten saved. This is where this came up. The Gentiles get saved, the Judaizers come in and say, wait a minute, you have to be circumcised or you're not saved. And so that becomes very contentious. So wherefore my sentence is that we trouble not them which from among the Gentiles are turned to God, but that we write unto them that they abstain from pollutions of idols, from fornication, from things strangled, and from blood. Heavenly Father, God, thank you for tonight. Thank you for your word. I pray, God, that as we just, again, continue to walk through this book of Acts, that we will continue to be blessed to see how the early church put things together, how they dealt with doctrinal challenges. And Heavenly Father, God, how we see the church through this come to the place where it is established today. And so once again, this transitional book, this historical book, helps us to understand and to see why we take the stands that we take. And God, thank you for that. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Again, so as we begin to continue to walk through this book, wherefore my sense, my decision, this has been brought again to the Jerusalem Council, if you will. They listen to the accusations and they make a decision that we trouble not them which from among the Gentiles have turned to God. Now, as we know, the gospel went what? Jew first, then the Gentile. And so when it went to the Gentiles because of the rejection of the Jews, it goes to the Gentiles. The Gentiles believe. They listen, they hear, they embrace Jesus Christ, and they are getting saved. And so as they're getting saved, they're excited, and all of these things are going on around about them, and they're beginning to grow, and suddenly, here come these guys. And they should say, wait a minute, hold it. You're not being obedient, again, as we'll see in just a little bit, the law of Moses. Listen, you have to be circumcised or you're not saved. And can you imagine what that would do to a new believer, especially in that first century church? This is just being put together. This is just being built. There wasn't anything like it before. They can't say, hey, you know what, I'm going to go down to the Christian bookstore and get a book about this. They couldn't do that. There wasn't any place for them to turn. Everybody didn't have a Bible. And so suddenly these men are saying one thing and these guys are saying something else and the confusion is reigning. And so they take it again. Where was the if you will, the pinpoint of Christianity? Jerusalem. We'll take this to the church of Jerusalem. And so they take it back there. And as they walk through, it says the Gentiles are turned to God, but that we write unto them that they abstain, and the word here abstain means to distance or avoid. And so, listen, abstain, distance, avoid pollutions of idols, from fornication, from things strangled, and from blood. Now, the interesting thing here as we walk down through, and as we've seen before, and we will continue to see in the New Testament, they are told that, listen, we no longer are under the law, right? No longer under the law. Well, then what does this mean? Well, wait a minute. These ideas come from where?
The law.
And so they, listen, we need to ask them to do something. They're not held to the law, and we will see that in just a minute. They're not being held to the law, but we're asking them to abstain, to distance themselves, to avoid. The way that this is written is not telling them you have to obey the law. They're simply asking them Will you abstain from this? Will you distance yourself from these things? Because what? It's causing a problem. And we're not to become a what to the brethren?
Stumbling block.
To the brethren, and so let's just avoid these things. It is in no way suggesting that they obey the law. It's simply asking them if they will avoid these things. And so if they will abstain from pollutions of idols. The idea of pollution is not, again, referring to the worship of idols. It is talking about the pollution of idols, which means anything that has to do with the worshiping of idols. Paul deals with this later on. What about the meats, worship to idols? And those types of things, how do we deal with these things? Are they polluted? And the idea here is they're asking them to abstain at this point in time from the pollution of idols. Those things that are involved with idol worship. And from fornication, of course, that continues always. You know, the sexual sin, we're to avoid that absolutely always. From things strangled, goes back, again, to the Jewish position, to the position of the law, on that which was not bled. Okay, when it was killed, it was to be bled. And if that didn't happen, it was strangled. Okay, we'd say, well, what in the world were they strangled? Hey, any kind of fowl, any chicken, ducks, any, very easily strangled them. And yet that was not, they had to be what? Bled. And so telling you, please abstain from those things and from things strangled and from blood. And of course, a lot of people have looked at that and said, well, wait a minute, just ask them to avoid strangling, which is the blood situation. Why do they turn around and tell them to avoid blood again? Because it's talking about the shedding of blood. Killing people. Listen, the Jews and the Gentiles hadn't had a real good relationship. And so this is talking here about this matter of the shedding of blood. And so the idolatry, the immorality, the bloodshed, and of, again, some of the dietary code, they're just saying, listen, abstain from that right now. And so they're just being asked to do this. For, in verse 21, it says, for Moses of old time hath in every city them that preach him, the preacher preach Moses, being read in the synagogues every Sabbath day. Well, what does that mean? He's talking about those who, for Moses of old time hath in every city them that preach him, that teach the law of Moses. Okay, that's what they're talking about. They're going back, they're teaching the law of Moses, when in fact, the Jewish Messiah, Jesus Christ, has already come. Mm-hmm. That prophecy has absolutely been completely fulfilled. Grace has overtaken law. Law is to be pushed back. Moses and the law of Moses is now starting to fade away. And the grace given by Jesus Christ is to start to take over through the church. And that has not taken place. There are those in every city that continue to preach Moses. Verse 22, then pleased it the apostles and the elders with the whole church to send chosen men of their own company to Antioch, that's where the question had come from, and Paul and Barnabas, namely Judas, surnamed Barsabas, and Silas, chief men among the brethren. When this was said, when they come and say, okay, here is my sentence. This is what needs to be done. Please ask them to abstain from these four things. Other than that, listen, we're no longer under the law of Moses, period. It pleased, and this is a very important point here. When that decision is made, you listen to decisions made under our politicians and different things, and when the decision is made, what happens? Everybody's pleased? Oh, no. There are some places, especially within the political environment right now in the United States, 49% are happy and 51% are mad, or the other way around. And so they just split right down the middle. Listen, here, when this sentence was given, then pleased it, number one, the apostles, and then the elders, all the pastors, with the whole church. Listen, they listened to this. This is fantastic. This is what we've been taught. This is what we understand. This is what we believe. And it pleased the whole church. And they wrote letters by them after this manner, the apostles and elders and brethren sent greetings unto the brethren which were of the Gentiles to Antioch, Syria, and Cilicia. For as much as we have heard that certain which went out from us have troubled you with words, subverting your souls, saying ye must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom we gave no such commandment. And so this is one of the reasons that, again, once this came out, once it was discussed, once the sentence was given, everybody's on the same page. Everybody's happy because these men, for as much as ye have heard that certain which went out, what does it say? From us. They went out from Jerusalem. They went unto them so they could say, hey, we're coming from here. And this is what we believe. They're suggesting, again, that this is exactly what the church in Jerusalem believes. And in this verse, he straightens it out. They have troubled you with words. What did they do? Subverting your souls. They brought a lie to you, claiming it was biblical truth. And they're subverting your souls. Listen, that very part of man that communicated with God, listen, it's subverting your soul. It's taking them away in their thinking from God. It is moving them away from the truth of the word. So again, they troubled you with words, subverting your soul, saying, okay, what was it that was this big deal? Ye must be circumcised, and not only that, but keep the law, to whom we have, what? No such commandment. None. That's why we know that when they asked about abstaining from those four things, that they were not making it law. They were not saying, listen, you have to obey these four things of the law. Because they make it very plain by verse 24, that is not what they were suggesting at all. Because he tells them here, ye must be circumcised to keep the law, to whom we gave no such commandment of obeying the law. That was not given. And so, again, the idea of it, subverting, that word that is used here, it literally means plundering or ravaging their souls. This was terrible. These are young believers, and we see the cults do this to this very day.
That's right.
You have some young believer, or even some folks who've been going to church a long time, but they haven't spiritually grown. And all of a sudden, a cult comes along. Hi, can we come in and have a Bible study with you about Jesus Christ and your relationship with Christ? We would just love to stop by. Yeah, we do this once a week. Just come in and sit down and just have a conversation with you about Jesus Christ. Ooh. And then they come in, and what do? They bring in their lies. And they bring in, you know what? Jesus Christ is not God. And they start on such things as that. And they start removing the deity of Jesus Christ.
Right.
There are other cults. What? They come in, they say, listen, you need to understand that, you know, listen, we need to obey the law. But they have their group of laws to obey. Not all the law, which the Bible is very clear. If you if you have to obey one, you got to obey them all. And so, you know, listen, this doesn't work coming in with, well, we believe you got to do these six laws, or whatever it may be. And so we have these cults. We have these liars going door to door, subverting these souls. And then again, this idea of plundering, ravaging their understanding of the truth of the Word of God. That's what was happening here. When they came in, they said, no, no, law of Moses, you have to do these things or you are not saved. But can you imagine what that would do? You think you're saved. You think you just got saved. You are wondrously saved in Jesus Christ. You're overjoyed about your salvation, and somebody shows up and goes, you're not actually saved. You have to do some things. Well, I tell you what, that sidetracks some people. That really throws them off. That's the idea of subverting their souls.
Right.
It throws them off of what? The truth of salvation. Verse 25 through 27. It says, it seemed good to us, being assembled with one accord, that we had one reason, deal with this problem, to send chosen men unto you, with our beloved Barnabas and Paul, men that have hazarded their lives for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. They have put themselves in peril for the Lord Jesus Christ. We have sent, therefore, Judas and Silas, who shall also tell you the same things by mouth. So here's the letter, signed by the Church of Jerusalem. We're going to send it with these men. And these guys, again, they just pointed at him, Judas and Silas, who shall also tell you the same things by mouth. We send the letter, and we also send what? Testimony. Verbal testimony. This is going to be told you. You can read it. And also the testimony of these men, seeing that this is true. This is the decision. This was the sentence. You don't have to obey the law. The law is done. Our salvation is grounded and founded in grace and grace alone.
Amen. Amen.
And so they nail this down, and they take this then to these churches. For it seemed good to the Holy Ghost. I like that. Seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us. What's good, it seemed good to us, seems it was good with the Holy Ghost, right? If he's leading and guiding the church, we should be paying attention. For it seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things, that ye abstain from meats offered to idols, from blood, from things strangled, from fornication, from which, if ye keep yourselves, ye shall do well, fare ye well. Listen, so they're asking them to do these things. They've clearly said, this isn't about the law, this isn't about commandments, but we're asking you to do this. Goes on in verse 30. So when they were dismissed, they came to Antioch. And when they had gathered the multitude together, they delivered the epistle. They read the letter. They got there. They didn't, and by appearance, they didn't go, hey, is it okay if we read this letter, to anybody? They came to Antioch, and when they had gathered the multitude together, the church, they read the epistle, which when they had read, they rejoiced for consolation. The word consolation means for encouragement. And they were overjoyed. Their salvation itself had been questioned. It had been brought into question. You people are not saved because you're not obeying the law of Moses, at least parts of the law of Moses. And until you do that, you're not saved. And so what? This can shipwreck people. This can just move people away. Wait a minute. I was told this is the way of salvation. I have believed, I placed my faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross at Calvary. And now you're telling me that wasn't good enough? That now I have to obey the law? No, the finished work of Jesus Christ is final. And it is more than good enough.
Amen. Amen.
Listen, to question any such thing. But again, this reality, it seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things. I think the interesting thing about that statement is they are absolutely certain in their souls, in their hearts, in their thinking, that their decision to set aside the law, they were led by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Okay? They're not just showing up saying, you know what, it seemed good to us that this is the way it should have been done. No, like showing up and saying, it seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us, led by the Holy Spirit of God in decision making.
Right.
That is how decision making should always be done in the church. It should be Holy Spirit led decisions. It should never just go, I think we should do this. Why do you think that? I've put it to a lot of prayer. I've been in the Word of God, and this is my reasoning through the Word of God. Okay? That's one way, and that's the only way we should do it. But again, so often decisions are made, we really haven't thought it through, we haven't prayed about it, we haven't sought the leading and the guiding of the Holy Spirit. We're just making what seems good to us. I'm not sure that's good enough for God or the church. But again, as we continue to walk through verse 3, so when they dismissed, when they were done, read the letter, had the testimonies, they were dismissed, they came to Antioch, and when they had gathered the multitude together, they delivered the epistle, which when they had read, they rejoiced for consolation. This is wonderful. Exactly what we wanted to hear. Exactly what they believed when they were saved.
Amen.
Listen, I got saved by the blood of Jesus Christ, and I need nothing else.
That's right.
And so these men coming in, subverting the gospel, subverting the truth. Now, that's been set to rest. Has been looked at, has been examined, and that's been put aside. And so, verse 32, and Judas and Silas, being prophets also themselves, exhorted the brethren with many words. The idea here of prophets, I believe they're referring to also being preachers. Giving forth that which is happening in the future, but just forth-telling the word of God. But being prophets also themselves did what? Exhorted the brethren with many words and confirmed them. Well, what does that mean? They confirmed them in the truth of the word of God and of their salvation. Mm-hmm. They wanted to be sure that these people understood clearly that their salvation, again, was in Jesus Christ and was never in jeopardy. And so they want to see again, they confirm them. And after they had tarried there a space, they were let go in peace from the brethren unto the apostles. And again, okay, the idea here, they were let go. They're going to go ahead and send them back home. Okay, this is the idea. And so they go in peace from the brethren unto the apostles. Notwithstanding, it pleased Silas to abide there still. Those who had gone, those who had preached, those who had taught, those who had delivered the letter, those who had testified, all the things that they did. And then they preached. And as it said here, they confirmed them. They made sure that they clearly understood their position. And yet, here, we see Silas says, you know what? I'm going to stay a little longer. I'm going to minister to them. I want to continue. I look at this and I think, if you back up 100 years ago or more, when they started the big revival services across Europe, across the United States, they would come into a town, into a city, and they would set up what they called the tabernacle, huge tent tabernacle, enormous, see thousands of people. They'd be there 3 to 6 months. Revival meeting, 3 to 6 months. And then it got down to, well, that was 3 months. And then those revival meetings got down to a month. And then a couple of weeks. And now it's Sunday through Wednesday. Okay. But Silas, he looked around and said, no, I'm not done here. I'm not done. There's more to say. There's more to teach. There's more to preach. And I'm going to stay for a while. Paul also and Barnabas continued in Antioch, teaching, preaching the word of the Lord with many others also. Others joined with them. They stayed, they continued. And can you imagine having the likes of Paul and Barnabas and Silas, and it says, and many others, teaching, preaching, witnessing, inviting, doing all of those things that brings people to hear the word of God. And once they've heard the word of God, now it's decision time. They've heard the word. Okay, well, now what are you going to do with it? Now you know, what are you going to do with it? And just Jimmy Mercer comes to mind. He was an old-time evangelist, and Jimmy Mercer had called up from the minor leagues to the major leagues as a baseball player. And I'm not sure, I think it was Chicago called him. But anyway, got on the train, he lived down south in Florida. Got to Chicago, and in that train ride, God so moved in his heart that God had called him to preach. They simply got on the train going the other direction and went back. Got with this preacher and said, "Hey, preacher, look, God's called me to preach." "Okay, great. You preach Sunday." And then his preacher had a horse and buggy, and they went church to church to church. And Mercer told the story. They went to the first church. He said, "I was so nervous. I opened my Bible. I started reading," and he said, "literally sweat's just dripping on the Bible." And he said, "All of a sudden, I realized I didn't know how long I've been reading." He said, "I didn't know if I've been reading 2 verses, have I been reading for 20 minutes?" He said, "I didn't know." He said, "I simply stopped reading. And I looked up." He said, "People started coming down to the altar and weeping and asking forgiveness and getting saved." And he said, "Wow." You know, it was just this tremendous working of God. So he and the preacher go out, get in the buggy, and they go to the next church. And Mercy, but I got this figured out. Mm-hmm. Went in, read some scripture, stopped. Everybody just looked at him. You know, you're going to preach, what are you going to do? And the thing was, Jimmy Mercer went about and preaching, and he would read maybe 3 to 5 verses. He would expound on those 3 to 5 verses, and he'd say, "Okay, now you know what the Word of God says. What are you going to do about it?" I mean, that was it. That was a whole shebang. 10 to 15 minutes, he was done. "What are you going to do about it?" And he would come to Pillsbury Baptist Bible College when I was going there every year for a month. I want to tell you what, you saw kids. You saw some of the professors getting right with God. You saw people responding to this extremely simple message from the Word of God. This is what it says. What are you going to do about it? And again, what an interesting guy. But I always kind of, I look at, listen, we stayed. And many others. And we were preaching the gospel. There's laying out the truth of the Word of God to those in Antioch. And what are you going to do about it? How are you going to deal now with the truth? That's what we need to be doing as believers. Laying out the truth before people. And simply, what are you going to do about it? Here's the truth. Now, they can tell you, "I don't believe that." They can walk away. They can make whatever decision they want. But we're supposed to tell them the truth. And leave them to decide, what are you going to do about it? And that's kind of what, you know, as I looked at this, as I walked through it and read Paul and Barnabas continuing in Antioch, teaching, preaching the word of the Lord, and many others also. That's what I picture. They're just clearly, simply presenting the truth and asking people of Antioch, Heavenly Father, God, thank you for this evening. Thank you for your love. Thank you for all you've accomplished for us. Thank you for our salvation. And if there's one here who is not saved, might they be brought up by the Holy Spirit, who asks that question always. What are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about the truth? How are you going to deal with the reality of Jesus Christ? Heavenly Father, God, thank you. And we pray for those here, that we can be the witnesses that you have intended us to be. I thank you for this church. I thank you for these people here tonight. I pray now that Heavenly Father, God, you would be honored, that you would be glorified by what we do throughout this week. Heavenly Father, God, we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.